Hello, good evening. Welcome to this edition of the program. Thank you very much for your time. Tonight, we have a conversation that you have to pay attention to. If you have been monitoring the news and you are interested in the politics, the amanyosem, as they say in Chi, there's been some interesting developments today. At the Inter-Party Advisory Committee meeting today, the Electoral Commission admits that they may have to reopen the voters' register. It's not that alarming for people who have just come into Ghana because they were out of Ghana by reason of the closure of the airports, for people who were in quarantine for the period that the exhibition exercise was done, so they were unable to register, and for other people who couldn't register one way or the other. So that's the reason why you are seeing that headline, Electoral Commission to reopen the voters register. But President John Dramani Mahama has addressed a press conference today. His concern is that with all what is happening at the Electoral Commission, he is not confident that we are on the right path towards December 7th. He had very strong words to describe his capturing of the events today at the press conference. We'll show you that. And later on in our big interview tonight, Elbrus Efiri Ankrah, one of the most experienced election observers and election workers in Ghana since 2004, will be in the studio to tell us what exactly is the NDC's concern about the processes. And does the NDC see it as a fait accompli that really the elections will not work, or do they see it as a beginning of a process of negotiation? Thankfully, the NDC was at the IPAC meeting today. So Elvis is our main guest in the studio, will be talking to us. Before then, we'll speak on the phone to the Dr. Serebo, who is at the Electoral Commission in charge of elections. We'll be asking him what happened at the IPAC meeting today. And we do have a video captured from TV3's news of events that occurred in Binduri, where people went in and they couldn't see their names, etc., etc. And we'll ask Dr. Serebo sort of react to that as well. Dr. Serebo will be on phone to us live here in the studio, and after that Elvis Efiri Ankrah will be talking to us. We do also have an important birthday dedication for Asensu Buachi, the Deputy Chief of Staff and the parliamentary candidate of the MPP for Bantama. We'll be showing you that birthday dedication. It's interesting, you should see what President Akufo-Addo has said about him in some events relating to TESCON. Quite interesting. That's coming up later. Now though, I want to start with first things first. Here is what we thought was the most important 5 minutes of President Mahama's press conference today. Here's what he said.
The EC and our opponents suggest that these concerns we have expressed are an exaggeration. So I'd like to take a little time at this point to walk you through just a few of the numerous examples available to us. In the Binduri constituency of the Upper East Region, many cases of omission of voters' names have been detected. At the Narang Sago Primary School, not a single person out of 444 registered people could find their names on the register. At both the Tempielim Primary School and Kumpalguga Registration Centers, no name was found on the register, despite the registration of 428 people and 392 people respectively. In 18 other centers in the same constituency, 6,341 names were omitted from the register. In Jirapa, in the Upper West Region, a total of 2,057 names were nowhere to be found on the voters' register in 5 centers. I reiterate the demand of our General Secretary for the EC to publish in full the names and particulars of all persons issued with defective voters' ID cards. In addition to these very disturbing developments, we have noticed that the Commission failed to deploy BVD devices to all exhibition centers to allow for confirmatory fingerprint verification during the exhibition exercise. We further found out in some areas that there were huge differences between the total number of registrants as issued in the daily registration printouts, which was given to our agents during the voters' registration, and the total number of registrants contained in the provisional register at the same centers. As one of its main arguments for the compilation of a new voters' register, The Commission asserted that the methods and systems to be adopted for the compilation of this new register will eliminate the need for the process of manual verification. In view of this, Parliament approved a huge budget for the acquisition of 75,000 BVDs for all registration centers. One would think that these BVDs would have been deployed to each of the over 33,000 exhibition centers across the country in order to test the efficacy of the machines now. As it is, only 5,000 have been deployed nationwide, thus raising the possibility of widespread manual verification of voters on election day if these BVDs fail to function properly. All these matters, among others, must be discussed as part of a dialogue between EC and IPAC about the way forward. And finally, I wish to make an appeal to the international community, international election observers, and our domestic observers. Given all that has gone amiss with the electoral process and the likelihood of continued greater challenges ahead of this year's election, I'll want to urge them to focus their lenses on Ghana and arrive earlier in the country than ever before. This will enable them to engage the EC, IPAC, and all stakeholders as part of efforts to resolve these major problems with the register. My brothers and sisters, it matters very little whether the situation confronting us is a product of incompetence or malice or both. Our demands are the same regardless. We want to see fairness, transparency, and integrity in the process leading up to the election, including in this exhibition exercise. We expect that when such monumental breaches are pointed out, the EC will take responsibility and act in good faith to resolve them. We in the NDC have exhibited restraint at all times in this electoral process. Even now, we are committed to doing so. But let me serve notice once again that we will not accept the result of a flawed election.
Okay, so that's what President John Dramani Mahama said. When Elvis Efriankra joins us tonight, he'll give us better and further particulars about the NDC's concern relating to the voters registration exercise, the opening of the register, the exhibition, etc., etc. We are now going live on the phone to speak to Dr. Sribo, who is the head of elections at the Electoral Commission. But before then, let's see this news item that we captured off TV3's news, and it relates to what had happened during the exhibition in the particular constituency in the northern region called Binduri. This was the news item, and this is the evidence that was provided by a TV3 reporter.
Now, the fate of many prospective voters in the Binduri district of the Upper East region still hangs in the balance as their names remain missing from the voter register with only 3 days to end the ongoing exhibition exercise. Now, 25 out of the 80 polling station registers either had no names or numerous missing ones.
TV3 on Friday, September 18, reported on the missing names in the voters register displayed at Zwase and Zapalega polling stations in the Binduri district. That was the first day of the exhibition. And the two polling stations have only 14 and 4 names captured instead of 413 and 371 voters in the two registered. The Upper East Regional Directorate of the Electoral Commission confirmed the anomaly and promised to rectify it by Monday. However, our checks on Monday, September 31, also revealed more challenges for prospective voters in the district. The Zapalega Center, where only 4 out of 371 voters were captured on the register, had no exhibition activities on Tuesday, September 22, and the Electoral Commission officials were also not present. 25 out of the 80 polling stations either had no names at all or far less than expected. The Tempelim Deepa Life Church polling station, which has 428 voters, had no names, and the Electoral Commission officials were conspicuously missing at the center as at noon Tuesday. The Tempialem primary had 331 out of 523 voters on the register. The dismay of a prospective voter, Azure Azuma, sums up the frustrations of the residents of the community.
In fact, we Tempialem, we are very worried. Youth, old and young all, we are worried. So 11, 3 days for them to close the exhibition. We've not heard of anything. So we don't even know what about.
Others say they are contemplating a demonstration to register their grievances and ask the Electoral Commission to bring back the old register if it cannot effectively create a new one.
Does it mean that in election day, there will not be any register for those police stations to cash in their vote? But what we want Madam Jean Mensah to know is that she should do this correction.
3 days left for them to close, so we don't know what to do next. If our name did not come, then there will be a problem, because we are all Ghanaians. So we cannot stay and others will vote and we will not vote. And that problem will not be anything other, apart from demonstration.
At the Narang Sago Primary School, a center with 444 registrants, no name appeared on the voters' register and no EC official was on site. At the Zolse Primary School, EC officials were using exercise books to take down names of those who visited the polling station and did not have their names in the register.
Just this morning, when we called the officer, we were told that there is a paper for us to put our names down and our voter ID card numbers. They will get the register and later on call us to tell us whether our names are included or not. This, I don't think, is what we call exhibition. What they are doing now is compilation of names, which was done earlier as registration. So if they come to do this again, it defies the exhibition component in it. So we are not happy, and we want to say that the electoral staff at the polling station now at least should go back, and we know that at the Zolse Primary polling station, there's no exhibition going on.
According to the official who spoke off camera, the exercise book is to help them track those who could not find their names if the anomaly is corrected and a new register is brought in.
We still have only 14 names on the register. So as of now, we don't know what to say. So we want the authorities at least to take this matter up, and then at least so that come 7th December, we, the people of Zolse, can also come out to exercise our democratic rights.
Okay, so that's from Binduri in the northern region. Now we have Dr. Sribo on the phone to speak to us about these matters. Hello, good evening, Dr. Sribo.
Good evening, my brother.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Good evening, my brother.
How are you?
I'm doing good by the grace of God, and I hope so are you.
Yeah, we are all fine. Okay, let's start with the first things first. What decisions were taken at the IPAC meeting today?
Thank you very much. And my regards to your listeners and viewers. We have two agenda. The first one is about the ongoing exhibition exercise. And the second one is where to the registration for people who have not yet registered for the 2020 elections. So with respect to the ongoing limited registration, the commission explained to the meeting or the political parties some of the issues that they are complaining about, and so the assurance was given that as far as you are a registered voter and you have given a valid ID card, we will rectify any anomaly that is happening for you to cast a vote, unless you are involved in multiple registration or you have been put on exceptions list.
Okay,
so
let
that me, is the first assurance that
let,
was
let
given.
Let me start with the multiple registration. You published that 6,000 names have been found that had multiple registered. Have you been able to delete the superfluous registrations of these individuals, or are you going to take them out completely and prosecute them? What are you going to do?
We normally quarantine you in the register so that you are not active in the register, but you are still in the register so that you cannot register again. So those people will be removed from the main register and put on multiple lists. So what it means is that on 7th of December, they cannot vote. But because they have been quarantined, they cannot register until the decision is taken on them.
Okay, how many are they? How many are these people?
They are, I think, 6,380. I'm not so sure about the figure. 6,380, around that figure.
Okay, and this is from all over the country?
Yes, all over the country.
Okay, so why are we having the problems we are having? We just showed a video from Binduri where people have showed up and their names are not in the register. What has accounted for this?
Yes, the Binduri one and other centers, I think there was a problem with respect to the export or the transfer. Now, we have three levels of transfers, and I believe along the line, we lost some of the information or data. One at the registration center or the polling station, a flash stick is used to download the data and send to the district office for export into the national database. So that's so we pick it from the polling station, we export at the district level, it goes to the national database. Then in printing, the system is sent into the printing for it to be printed at different locations. Where the data center is different from where the printing is done. So we lost some of the data. So what we are doing now is that we are going into the system itself that we call end of life. So for Binduri, we have captured every data, and as of today, I know it was ready. So either it is gone or it will go, and from tomorrow going, they can do their continue with their exhibition.
Okay, President Mahama said something about extending the exercise beyond 2 days. Some people agree with him. Is this something that the commission wants to consider, given the magnitude of the anomalies that have been talked about?
What we should understand is that all these people will vote in a day, just one day. So what we are saying is that if we have one day to do the exhibition, you can get it. And people can still use the 1422 short code to check on their names. So I don't think after the 2 days extension that we have already granted, we will do the extension again. But people can still use the short code to check on their names, or they can go to the center from today to Sunday to check, from Friday to Sunday to check on their names.
Okay, the NDC also accused you of padding up in some constituencies, so that whereas in places like Binduri, the names did not appear, in other places, more names appeared than ought to be. Is that correct?
You see, the first thing that I want to say is that it's an issue of trust. So if there's no trust, it is difficult for you to appreciate whatever happens. We shouldn't lose out on the fact that we did some of the decision at the district offices. And when you register at the district office, you decide where you want to vote and your name will send there. So assuming at the registration center you have registered 500, and 5 people register at the district office, the number will go up by the 5. There are some areas too are serving the secondary schools. We shouldn't lose out on the fact that the secondary schools were registered and assigned to police stations, which are also close by. So assume a school has about 500 students. Automatically, that particular police station that you are going to assign them will be shut up by that 500. So it is an issue of trust, and I believe if the trust was there, just a matter of coming to the commission to seek clarification. But we should also remember that all these figures that we are talking of, we gave the political parties end of life. And so, end of day report. So they will also know the end of the day report indicates the polling station that those people in the schools and the teachers have been assigned to. So if you do that computation automatically, you aware that no figure has been added, that you have added those who resided out of within the district and the schools to the actual in that took place at the registration centers.
Okay, let's talk now about the supplementary registration. So you said that you are opening the register for persons who were not available in the country or those who were under quarantine. Does it include ordinary people who, for some reason, because they were frustrated by long queues, did not register. Does it include that category of people?
If you read the CI 91, that government legislation, the law is clear that we are supposed to register people to the 60th day to the election. So do that, we can register you, but if you register you less than 60 days, you cannot add you to the register of that particular election. And there's a judgment against the commission back on Canada and the Electoral Commission. And the judgment was that we are mandated to register people. So the commission has decided that on the 1st of October, we will register people who have not yet registered. So it means that if you have just turned 18, you can register. If you are out of the country, you are in Ghana, you can register. If you are quarantined, you can register. The most important thing is that you qualify as a Ghanaian to register. We'll give you the opportunity on the 1st of October to register.
Where will this opportunity be given? Which polling stations are you opening for this purpose?
The polling stations or the things that will be the district offices. So we are only opening the district offices for this registration. So when you go to the district office, like we did for the vulnerables, you just say that you want to assign to this place or that place. And we expect the political parties to be there to observe. And at the end of the day, they will get their end of day report to know how many people have been included and that.
So you are assuring us that within the next 3 days, by the time the exhibition is over, everything President Mahama alleged today would have been corrected?
Almost all of them have been already been corrected. Almost. But to the best of my knowledge, all those areas with which you get, they have been rectified. Because you get much of, one, you know the specific problem, you pick the actual, the kit, that was, you do the end of that and you get the data. So the data is sitting on the machine, but the transfer and the rest. That's why there are some people, when they test, they are short, because I need to shortcode, the name is there, but it's not in the register. So I said that some of them are lost along the process that I've given you. But when you take the main, the data is sitting there.
Okay, so assuming that I did not use the short code to check my registration status, and I also did not turn up at any exhibition center, and I turn up on voting day, and my name is not in the register at the La Wireless Primary 1 Junior Secondary School, which is my polling station, would I be denied voting even though I'm holding the card?
The first thing is that we wanted everybody to check. But if you did not check, it does not mean that your registration is invalidated. It's valid. As long as you are doing register, your name will be on the register. But to make assurance double sure, we wanted everybody to go and check on this or their name.
Under what circumstance would I not be allowed to vote on December 7th, even though I have a card? Under what circumstance?
When you go to the center, your name will be on the register. Whether you have a card or not, you'll be allowed to vote.
So once I have a card, I'll be allowed to vote on December 7th anyway?
No, what I mean is that you should be on the register. And whether you have a card or not will not invalidate your voting. So the first assurance is that once you are duly registered, your name will be in the register. But the most other side of it is that, but if you were involved in multiple registration, your name will not be in the main register, but there will be a multiple list at the center that will show that you have registered at this place and that place. And if you have a reception list too, your name will not be in the main register, you can't vote, but your name will show. So there are three lists. Either your name will be on the main register. If it's not there, then your name should be on either the multiple list or the exception list. In such situations, you can vote.
Okay, so another scenario, just the final one. I'm a reporter for news, and I am not able to do special voting. On election day, I happen to be in Ashanti region, even though I registered in Greater Accra region. Can I turn up at any polling station in Ashanti region and exclude myself from voting in the parliamentary elections, but ask to be allowed to vote in the presidential election?
You are to vote at your polling station. If the media, we have asked you to submit your name through the media commission. So they will put you on the early voting or special voting. So you will cast your vote about 4 or 5 days to the election. If your name is not on that register, it means that your particular will not be on the BVD for that spring, so you cannot go there.
Even if I'm voting only in the presidential election?
Well, you need to be verified. And the BVDs are constituency specific. So you cannot vote in a constituency where you are not. Then, when it is assigned to a polling station, it is now customized for a specific polling station. So if you are registered in polling station A, you can't vote in polling station B, even though that BVD will contain the names of all the people in that constituency. So if you don't belong to that polling station, your name will not be in that machine. And if your name is in that machine, you cannot be verified. And once you can be verified, you can vote.
Okay, well, final, still on that point. So if verification really is the important denominator, can the polling station where I am reporting in Ashanti, say, Menchia South, can they make a phone call to La Wireless Primary School polling station to check whether they can verify me and then I can vote over there?
Verification is biometric. Verification is biometric, so phone calls will not verify you. Your name should be on the BVR kit. You will put your hand on it, and the system will verify you. So a phone call will not put your name on the machine.
Okay. So those of you at the Electoral Commission at the top level, like you, like Dr. Bosman Asare, and like Madam Jean Mensah, where and when are you going to vote?
It's our choice. We will decide to vote on the third day. In that case, we have to apply not less than 42 days to the election, or we will vote on the 7th of December at where we registered.
So why did you register yourself, Dr. Srebo?
I registered in my hometown, at Makute Timan.
Oh, that means you will not be here on voting day, you will be there.
I can use the special voting or I can use proxy.
Which party would you be voting for?
I will vote for a Ghana party. And I will vote for a candidate of my choice. And that is between me and my God. And probably my party.
So when you finish voting, you'll be expecting that the candidate that you voted for should win the election?
That is my choice, but Ghanaians will decide.
Don't you think perhaps maybe you shouldn't vote at all?
Yes, I have the right as a Ghanaian to vote, but I should allow Ghanaians to choose who should rule out. I only have one.
Okay. I have to congratulate the Electoral Commission, though, for the timetable that you published, which was very incisive and direct. You said that the voting was going to be on December 7th and the results will be declared on the afternoon of December 10th. Is that still the case?
That is our prayer and hope that it will be so.
What could change that?
We are human beings and God is tight on everything. It is possible. But we hope we don't get there. That the whole day it can rain, that you cannot even go out and vote. God has a way of doing things. So if God allows us, that should be. But we cannot decide for God.
And that if there should be a second round, it will be held on the 28th of December.
Exactly so.
Okay, so would you organize to meet with the NDC, given that their presidential candidate has held this press conference today, and sort of explain to them what you have just explained to our viewers?
We did this discussion today with the political parties, and I believe their reps were convinced before leaving the place.
Did the NDC attend the IPAC meeting today?
Yes, today they came, and I know that IT guy, IT man, Kwame Griffith, and Mr. Amati were their reps.
Oh, okay. We are going to speak to Elvis Ankara, who is their director of elections. If it becomes necessary, we will call you again, Dr. Srebo. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, and God bless you.
That was Dr. Srebo of the Electoral Commission. I hope that you enjoyed the interview. Next on the agenda is Elvis Efuye Ankara. I think that he sorted it out quite nicely. For me, the most important answer he gave was the the adding up, the pardon, which was a concern for President Mahama, which became a concern for everyone as soon as President Mahama mentioned it. He says that the so-called additions that people are seeing in the polling station, different from what occurred at the end of the voting, is because people were registered outside the polling station who said that this was their constituency. So if I was a student at Domain Hinkro Secondary School, but my polling station is La Wireless Primary School, JSS, in La, then when I'm registered at Domain Hinkro during the registration of students, if I'm above the age of 18 or I am 18, I will tell them that I want my registration to be at La Wireless, and so they will include it. So I'll not physically be at La Wireless, but my name will be sent there. That sounds like an interesting explanation that we'll put to Obisa Fuyankara when he joins us. Now, though, before I take the break, there's a big birthday dedication that I have to do. Some of these young men who joined politics are doing quite well. One of them is Asensu Bwachi. He's a deputy chief of staff of Nana Adodanko Akufo-Addo. Ordinarily, he's a quiet man, but he's a man of great political thought and great insight. Happy birthday to you, our dear member of parliament, parliamentary candidate for Bantama. Almost certainly, Asensu is going to be the member of parliament, given the dynamics in Ghana. If you're running on Ashanti seat like Bantama and you are MPP, it's just a matter of the numbers that you'll be able to pull. But that's a great constituency that he has inherited from Cecilia Dapa and others who have all been Bantama MPs. Today is his last birthday before voting day. Happy birthday, Asensu.
I have perforce also to mention the name of my deputy chief of staff and political assistant, Francis Asensu Bwachi. The founding president of TESCOM, who has proved to be invaluable to me in my work and is desirous of joining his colleagues in Parliament.
Enjoy the evening of your birthday, Francis Asensu Bwachi. Thank you. Okay, well, back on Good Evening. Somehow, Elvis Efriankra is still not in the studio. Some men have arrived who work with him, and so we are anticipating that he will come in soon. But if you know him, just call him that we are waiting for him on Good Evening Ghana. His people are here. Tell him that if he's looking for his people, they're already here. They have his file, they have his documents and all that, but he himself is not here yet. Never mind. Hopefully, he'll be here soon. It's 15 minutes to the top of the hour. We take a short break. We'll be back on Good Evening Ghana. It's live.
I'm Jessica Daniel, and I welcome you to Jamila Home.
Jamila Home is undeniably the most prestigious deco showroom in Ghana and Africa. We blend value with authority. My name is Nanaya Wapo, and I welcome you to an undiluted royalty.
Our primary focus is centered on creating an executive and ambassadorial environment for your homes and offices. Our class of unique products ranges from luxurious chandeliers to valuable antique and high quality furniture. My name is Wisdom Kojo Sabla. Welcome to Jamila Home.
Imagine driving into your own home was no longer a dream, but a reality. Imagine a luxury home designed so people like you can afford. But imagination is considered thoughtless by some, maybe because we tend to be carried away by our imaginations or left misguided. At Rehoboth Properties, we understand imagination differently. In order to imagine something, one must dream. The Nightbridge, Kwabinya, is designed for dreamers like you. Households with varying financial capacities, offering a total of 1,700 one, two, and three-bedroom apartments on sale at unbelievable prices, so you can achieve your dreams and create with us a better future for all.
Ghana for high sense domosibe bray. Nitu tu anya pomudia jumaye for. Corona ya rebaye. Mone ya dini ye. Ya kosu asre se. Abansi se yo diegu akwemno. Ya mkosu na ye niso. Ye ye di entra. Se upe home appliances a efe. Na eche. Ne buwa dafom. Afe enche power. Yo biabe kembia obwa. Enwane high sense. High sense niema. Eye direct from factory. Ya na ye ye. Inti yetimiye promotion abribi ya. High sense product abeto. Or Ghana, and one of it all Germany and America. Your fridge, air condition, TV, washing machine, gas cooker, blender, rice cooker, mobile phones, sound system, and if you break it home. You have 5 years manufacturer defect warranty. You have mano, you have to swam on say, so say here, no nose mask, no entry. High sense, everyday prices for everyday people.
Madam, stop it!
Why?
This attitude of dumping rubbish anywhere in Ghana is a thing of the past.
Sorry.
We join Zoom Lion to declare, we believe in Ghana. We believe as a nation we can make it if we try.
Believe that as a nation we can make it if we try. We believe in Ghana. We believe.
Elections 2020. Campaign time is here. Honorable, your people must know your mission. Your people must hear your message. Your people would vote. Appointed Time Printing is offering you a wide range of printing solutions. Design and print your quality campaign t-shirts, polo shirts, posters, banners, stickers, scarves, nose masks, aprons, campaign flags, billboards, and vehicle brandings at very competitive prices. And we deliver on time at your doorstep, free within Accra and Tema. We also offer studio services. Take pictures, create designs, and print for you. At Appointed Time, we partner you to victory. Order now. Contact us on 050-145-4165 or 050-145-4167. We are located at the old GNTC building near Kingsway, Accra. Follow us on social media at Appointed Time GH. Victory 2020. Go for it!
Imagine driving into your own home was no longer a dream, but a reality. Imagine a luxury home designed so people like you can afford. But imagination is considered thoughtless by some, maybe because we tend to be carried away by our imaginations or left misguided. At Rehoboth Properties, we understand imagination differently. In order to imagine something, one must dream. The Nightbridge, Kwabinya, is designed for dreamers like you. Households with varying financial capacities, offering a total of 1,700 one, two, and three-bedroom apartments on sale at unbelievable prices, so you can achieve your dreams and create with us a better future for all.
Fellow Ghanaians, your friend Nalen Ghani Omezogweze of Kafam the First, Chief of Fufule. Some are catching that. Say Kafam the whole Ghana. To say any double do. Yet it is no near side chewa febre. Kafam, yen kokoa promo no. Double do ni. Let's go 440 liter bottom preserve me. I could have dispenser. Ah nani born here 2999. Say ye de about 2499. 500 Ghana, away! Yes, I'm a free media 20 liter microwave.
Captain Katina, when you can you my sushi?
Kafam, Kaya Su, you're not a chow.
Kafam, you're the home appliances, no? A chow ampa. Even in Dagbani. Kafam, we're lying. So good, we got a 640 liter side by side fridge, you know? Aha! Now, and also, so, I have 4999. To say, I have 3999
Thousand cities. Away! Ghana is a beautiful country. There is so much of it you probably haven't seen, haven't experienced, haven't touched, haven't felt, haven't eaten. When this is all over, let's discover our land again, with new eyes. Let's feel each other again. We are one people, brought together by destiny. Let's make that count. Let's show love for each other and our environment. Let's tell our stories, and let's watch and listen to our stories. There'll be so much to tell. Ghana is a truly beautiful country. Be Ghana. Stay in Ghana, experience Ghana, make Ghana great. And we will invite the world to come and experience Ghana too. But for now, stay home. Brought to you by the National Film Authority. Support the Stay Home and Discover Ghana Later campaign. This channel supports the campaign.
Okay, Elvis Efriankra is here, our good old friend. He was in another studio, GH1. What did you tell the viewers of GH1?
Yeah. Let's do our program.
How are you doing, though?
Very well, very well. How are you doing? Sorry,
we've played President Mahama's tape. Would you like us to play it again for emphasis, or you speak to it?
Oh, it depends on you.
It's 5 minutes long.
Then that's okay.
Should we play it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's see what President Mahama said this afternoon again. Let's see it.
The EC and our opponents suggest that these concerns we have expressed are an exaggeration. So I'd like to take a little time at this point to walk you through just a few of the numerous examples available to us. In the Binduri constituency of the Upper East Region, many cases of omission of voters' names have been detected. At the Narang Sago Primary School, not a single person out of 444 registered people could find their names on the register. At both the Tempielim Primary School and Kumpalguga Registration Centers, no name was found on the register, despite the registration of 428 people and 392 people respectively. In 18 other centers in the same constituency, 6,341 names were omitted from the register. In Jirapa, in the Upper West region, a total of 2,057 names were nowhere to be found on the voters' register in 5 centers. I reiterate the demand of our General Secretary for the EC to publish in full the names and particulars of all persons issued with defective voters' ID cards. In addition to these very disturbing developments, we have noticed that the Commission failed to deploy BVD devices to all exhibition centers to allow for confirmatory fingerprint verification during the exhibition exercise. We further found out in some areas that there were huge differences between the total number of registrants as issued in the daily registration printouts, which was given to our agents during the voters' registration, and the total number of registrants contained in the provisional register at the same centers. As one of its main arguments for the compilation of a new voters' register, the Commission asserted that the methods and systems to be adopted for the compilation of this new register will eliminate the need for the process of manual verification. In view of this, Parliament approved a huge budget for the acquisition of 75,000 BVDs for all registration centers. One would think that these BVDs would have been deployed to each of the over 33,000 exhibition centers across the country in order to test the efficacy of the machines now. As it is, only 5,000 have been deployed nationwide, thus raising the possibility of widespread manual verification of voters on election day if these BVDs fail to function properly. All these matters, among others, must be discussed as part of a dialogue between EC and IPAC about the way forward. And finally, I wish to make an appeal to the international community, international election observers, and our domestic observers. Given all that has gone amiss with the electoral process and the likelihood of continued greater challenges ahead of this year's election, I'll want to urge them to focus their lenses on Ghana and arrive earlier in the country than ever before. This will enable them to engage the EC, IPAC, and all stakeholders as part of efforts to resolve these major problems with the register. My brothers and sisters, it matters very little whether the situation confronting us is a product of incompetence or malice or both. Our demands are the same regardless. We want to see fairness, transparency, and integrity in the process leading up to the election, including in this exhibition exercise. We expect that when such monumental breaches are pointed out, the EC will take responsibility and act in good faith to resolve them. We in the NDC have exhibited restraint at all times in this electoral process. Even now, we're committed to doing so. But let me serve notice once again that we will not accept the result of a flawed election.
Okay.
Yep.
We will not accept the results of a flawed election.
Mm-hmm.
Why does he want international observers to come in early?
Because looking at the state of affairs and the fact that prior to this register compilation, we had over 40 CSOs, houses of chiefs, various think tanks, urging them to open up, to reason, listen to alternative views. They refused, they persisted. And all these things that are happening, and unfortunately, I'm sad to say this, and you will bear me witness, right on this program, I told you that the path the EC is pursuing is going to lead us to chaos. Because there's a reason why international best practices, conventions, the ECOWAS protocols, even common sense dictates that you don't introduce a new register and new technical systems 6 months before an election. For the simple reason that already an election itself generates a lot of tension anyway. And if you're introducing a new system that has not been tried and tested 6 months before an election, the tendency is for you to rush things. And if you introduce technology that has not been tried and tested and deployed on a wide scale, there's the likelihood that by election day, when you deploy them and you come across challenges, it will be too late for you to have a backup plan. So upgrade the old register and then let's work with it and buy new equipment. They refuse. So, well, we went ahead. Today, everything that we predicted, everything that civil society predicted, everything that institutions predicted is what we are seeing today. Is it not very sad?
Which is what, that names are missing in the register?
So, first of all, I think that it's very worrying and frightening when the EC and some people want to belittle the current situation in which we're facing and make it look like it's not a problem. In fact, when I saw the EC's first press statement and then the second one they did yesterday, that they've been very transparent and open, I was very angry. Because you see, the implications of what is happening now are very, very serious, and they are a threat to our democracy. For an election to be credible, you need a credible register.
Yes.
Beyond a credible register, you need to create an environment where people have confidence in the electoral process. So if consistently you've had an EC that through its actions, its deeds and misdeeds, acts of omission and commission, they've displayed a certain posturing that does not engender the confidence of the stakeholders, you already have a problem. And then added to that, you have a situation where you've been given over 1 billion Ghana cedis. You say you're going to get us a brand new register that we've never seen before. And then you bring us a register. Paul, do you know what it means to have same PIN numbers for different people? It means that your telephone number, you go to MTN, you go to any network. They give you a telephone number. I go, they give me the number. They give same to your cameraman. They give same. It's unheard of because these are system generated. They're not generated by human beings. So how come that a system
I don't know about that example. Is it Professor Nana Jane Opokwajima's example?
No.
What is PIN number? I have my voter's card here.
PIN number is your personal identification number.
On the voter's card?
Yes. So it's a unique number.
Yeah, it has to
that
be.
That is generated for you. So it's like a bank account number.
And some
it's
of the unique problems that we are facing now is that two people have the same
PIN
number.
It is one of the major problems.
Well, not even the omission of the names.
No. I'll deal with them one at a time.
Okay.
It is one of the major problems that you have many different people with similar PIN numbers.
Who is observing that? How did you notice that?
How did we notice that?
Yes.
Because you go to the polling station when they started the exhibition.
Uh-huh.
You go, so this is a published list of voters in your branch.
Yes,
okay?
Yeah.
We go, and then you go and check, and you see that all the numbers are the same of the PIN numbers.
Of different names?
Yes, different names. So that's one. Mm-hmm. Now, that is unheard of.
So that was observed system by your people, NDC people?
By our people.
Did MPP find the same thing?
And I don't know, I don't speak for MPP.
Well, I know, but at the IPAC meeting today, did it sort of come up?
Did your people who you sent there mention
that we observed?
Absolutely.
What did the EC say?
The EC's attitude and posturing, like I said, consistently, it's been one of, we are the EC, we are independent, the Constitution guarantees us freedom. You've heard Bosman Asari saying all those
things. Yeah, I know, but this particular one, was it, if it was found in NDC by NDC branch people and MPP didn't complain, then I'm interested in looking at it further.
I don't speak for the MPP.
But at the IPAC, you see, today when I asked Cerebo about the IPAC, he said two things were discussed at IPAC today. The supplementary registration and names missing from the register. He didn't mention this PIN thing.
No, so let me just make my point. My point is that our representatives, okay, let me just put the issues in a proper. So we wrote a letter to the EC, all right?
Before today's IPAC
Yes. Exhibition of 2020 Provisional Register matters arising. We have noted with dismay a press statement issued by the EC on the 21st September titled Misleading Video on Social Media. When we found that video of W. Kumar Central or whatever it is, and then we issued a statement, we did a press conference, then they came out to say the video was misleading. That was the title of their. But in the video, they admitted that they had authorized their staff to do it. So it's like, yeah, what you saw is not true, but the contents are true. Doesn't make
what
sense.
What are the contents of that video for the benefit
in
of the viewers?
In that video, we saw officials of the EC printing voters' ID cards
new ones.
In the dead of the night for people. Now, that does
Who was filming it?
Eh?
Who was filming it?
Well, that is not important. The important thing is that it went viral. Everybody
okay, but the EC denies it.
So they said misleading video. That was their initial.
Okay.
But in the same statement, they now admit that they authorized that. Why? Because they found out that many people had the problem that I'm talking to you about that you are shocked about. That many people had cards that had duplicate same numbers.
Okay, so they were changing it.
So they were changing it. Now, the question to ask is, how do we procure cards? You go to the polling station, they take a picture of you, they give you your card in the presence of political parties. Then we take records. So everybody knows that on X days, 10 number of cards, 100 cards were done. This one, first of all, you have not told us that this problem has occurred.
So you're doing it without agents?
Without the knowledge of the political parties. Number two, which is more egregious, how many people did you determine have that problem?
But it appears that was not part of today's IPAC meeting.
Hold on. We are dealing with it. The world does not begin and end with today's IPAC meeting.
Issues, I know, but it's a major problem. Should have been on the table.
Saying the issues, so our people raised it. And I'm saying before then, we had also raised it to them.
I understand.
Okay. So the point is that when we raised that issue, then they initially said it wasn't true. Then they came to say they did. Now, how then do you, let's give an example of a chairman. As we speak today, 7,000 people do not have their names on the register. If the EC
says... But that's not one polling station, is it? Many polling stations.
Many polling stations, but one constituency.
Okay, Ashaman, yes.
So if you say you were printing cards for them, or even let's stick to Ablekuma, how did you inform the people? How will the people know?
And Ashaman is an NDC stronghold.
Yes,
we won it over the last
years. Yes, so how would the people know that they are part of the persons whose ID cards were duplicated?
But how will they distribute it to the people?
Exactly.
They call them to come for it?
That's precisely the point.
Has the EC admitted that in Ashaman they are printing new cards for people?
No. Ashaman's case is different, but I just use that hypothetical. Let's stick to
which
Ablekuma.
Constituency is Ablekuma is where they are printing cards for people?
Yes.
Have they confirmed that they are printing cards for people in Ablekuma?
Oh, yes.
They have?
Yes. After the title of their release, that's
then how did they explain that today about how they will hand over those cards?
They have not been able to explain.
And how many people are involved in this?
We don't know. Because we are not part of it. So you see the problem we have? Paul, it's a serious matter. Okay.
But
so,
when you left the IPAC meeting today, were your people, did they give you a report that they were satisfied?
Absolutely not.
Because the EC says that the NDC people were satisfied.
Absolutely
they
not.
They mentioned Mr. Griffiths, your IT
Kwame
man.
Griffiths and
what
my
did Kwame Griffiths tell you?
Kwame Griffiths raised all the issues that we have raised.
At today's IPAC?
Yes.
But why did you attend, Honorable?
Because I was also preparing for the flag bearer's address.
Okay.
You know? The notice
but maybe
came,
given the importance,
hold on,
you
hold
should
on,
have
hold
there.
On. The notice of the IPAC meeting came yesterday night. We got it yesterday night, by which time we're deep into the preparation. In any case, we have a competent team. Kwame Griffiths is very competent. My deputy is very competent, and I can't be at every meeting. So
what does Griffiths tell you?
So Griffiths and my deputy told me they raised the issues, all the issues that we have raised in the letter, which, like we said, what accounted for the issuance of voter ID cards with duplicate numbers, that is defective voter ID cards, by the Electoral Commission to registrants. A development which is unprecedented in the history of our electoral system. Was it as a result of the malfunctioning of the BVR equipment you recently procured or the sheer incompetence of the commission? Mm-hmm. When did the commission discover that some of the voter ID cards issued to registrants during the recent voter registration exercise had duplicate ID numbers and therefore defective? When did they realize it? Three, why did the EC not inform political parties who are major stakeholders in our electoral process of this grave anomaly and involve us in the resolution of same in the spirit of transparency and good faith? Why did the EC decide to print and distribute new voter ID cards to replace the duplicate ones without informing or involving political parties so we could deploy agents to monitor the process in accordance with our electoral laws and conventions? So had it not been that the video came out and they were exposed, they would have done this under cover of darkness. Then the EC in their response said misleading video. Then they now admit that they authorized them because they were defective. And then they go on to say that This is actually happening in 100 districts. Paul.
As much as 100.
100 districts.
That's almost half.
100 districts. So you ask yourself, what is going on? Are affected by the problem of defective voter ID cards across the country, as published in your press statement on 21st.
Hold on, let me see. Dr. Srebo, if you are listening to us, can we get you back on the phone? So we need to get an explanation of this. If Dr. Srebo is listening, please, let's get him back on the phone.
Okay. So we asked the EC, assuming without admitting that these are the only districts affected by this problem, we are requesting the commission to publish and furnish us with a total number of people affected by this problem and their identities so that we can contact them and help them go and change their cards, at least. They haven't given it to us. They haven't told us. Why is the Electoral Commission printing new voter ID cards without the presence of the affected persons? Because you are printing a card for me. My card was defective. You are printing a card. I mean, I should know. Mm-hmm. What is the guarantee that, assuming you determine that it's 100 people whose cards were defective, and then somebody surreptitiously then prints an extra 100, you know what they will do? Those 100 people, extra 100, will take their cards, go to an exhibition center, say, this is my card, but I am not on the list. And then they will give them inclusion forms, and they will find their names on the register. People who otherwise may not be qualified to vote. So it opens the room for fraud. Then since the EC only deemed it fit to invite political parties to participate in the card printing and distribution process yesterday, we are requesting the commission to furnish us with information on the quantity of cards printed so far, the number distributed so far, as well as the mode of distribution to enable us independently audit and verify. Nothing. Given the fact that we have just 2 days to the end of the registration, so we ask for extension and all that.
That they have done, the extension.
But the extension is meaningless. The extension is meaningless because you have not told us. You see, you want to deal with the problem. So I've dealt with the card aspect, the duplicate cards.
So today, how did the EC explain this?
They have not explained. That's the point I'm making.
So the IPAC meeting left ended without an explanation.
The only thing they said is that they're going to continue do registration. They'll do registration. So those
supplementary registration.
Yes. So those who otherwise could not register can register.
Yeah, they told us
and
that.
Those who for one reason or the other. But you have not dealt with the fundamental.
Are they going to continue printing the card? Are they going to continue printing?
That is the question you should ask them.
They didn't answer it.
You have not dealt with the fundamental problem. What is the cause of all these defects? Now, I haven't even come to the worst part of it. In some polling stations, you go to a polling station, you have 400 names. Mm-hmm. All the 400 names will have one picture.
Oh. Say my photograph for 400.
Yes.
On the paper.
Yes, this paper.
Well, but our cards will have different photographs.
Yeah, but why should that be?
It's a mistake.
Mistake?
Yes.
Biometric system? Has this ever happened before?
Srebo explained that there are three levels of transfer. Mm-hmm. And so in the process of transferring, they have been some difficulties. Mm-hmm. So those difficulties, he told the IPAC meeting today, 95% of them have been corrected. And
where
by the time...
Evidence?
He said, even in the Binduri we showed him that Binduri video. Even in Binduri, we are talking about, as at yesterday, people are finding their names on it. So
about Sherman?
He didn't mention
there are still 7,000 names.
Yeah, but he says that by the end of the process, all that will be resolved.
So what caused the problem?
We said the levels of transfer.
What does that mean?
It must be technical.
So what does that mean? Mm-hmm. And what assurance do we have that based on this level of incompetence that they've displayed, should we take them at their word? So one of the things we called
He complained
for,
about the trust that people don't have.
Who caused him? You want us to go there and to trust?
He talked about trust. Because I asked him about the padded thing, and that was really a concern for me when I first read the thing, and I'm sure many viewers do. And he said, there's just a matter of trust. You should trust them because they register people in offices, in districts, and in secondary schools who ask for their votes to be taken to those polling stations. Mm-hmm. So the numbers will be more at the exhibition period. Mm-hmm. More than the numbers at the close of registration, which sort of makes mathematical sense to me.
It makes sense because you don't understand the electoral system. Mm-hmm. You see, sometimes the explanations they give, they think that we are all in JSS. Okay? Mm-hmm. First of all, they don't know that for us as a political party, I don't know about others, for every polling station, we have the start of day report and end of day report.
Yeah, he said
so
they supply that to you.
So we as NDC, we have our register.
But that was given to you by the AC.
Yes, but we picked it.
Yes, correct.
Yes, it's our right.
Okay, I understand Srebo is on the phone now. Let's speak to him and get this issue resolved. Hello, Dr. Srebo.
Good evening, my brother.
Good evening. Thank you very much for your time again. We understand that the Honorable Evrese Fiyankra is saying that apart from the two issues that you said were discussed at the IPAC meeting, which is the missing names in the register and the supplementary registration, there's also another serious matter of serial numbers being the same for many people. Is that correct?
That's correct.
How did that come about?
Okay. Once again, good evening.
Good evening.
The IDs are generated by the kits. Mm-hmm. So when you enter the data center, that's where you're able to coordinate the activities of the individual kits. So when we send them, the system indicated that some of the ID numbers have been repeated. So the system itself will generate new ID numbers to repeat the multiple one. And the multiple one, the new ones will be printed for people and they are replaced. And this is done so far in 2012, it happened, 2013, it happened, and this year it happened. So it's not a new thing.
Okay, did you tell the political parties that this historical problem has reoccurred?
No, what we do is that when we print, we send them to the polling stations involved where the political parties are, and they help us to do the distribution.
So at which point were you going to tell them when the cards were printed?
What we're saying is that when they are printed at the head office, they are sent to the district and they are laminated. They are sent to the various police stations involved. So some districts may not be involved at all. In a district, some police stations may be involved, other districts may be involved. So they are sent to the police stations involved, and the political parties are there, then they have the distribution.
So if I am affected by this one, for instance, at which point would I know that I have to go and collect a new card?
Okay. First, let me establish that the IDs are not conditioned for voting. So we could have kept quiet. You wouldn't know. I believe that as of now, you yourself, you don't know your ID number.
No, I don't.
Yes, I also don't know mine. If the commission does not tell you, you wouldn't even know. But when they enter into a system, it is detected. Then the system will generate the unique ones for them. Then the cards will be printed for purpose. They are sent to the region. The region will send them to the district. The district will now laminate them and send to the various politicians concerned. And well, that's where the parties will be there. So what we normally do is that we have their telephone numbers, we have their residential addresses and the rest. It is a small community because it is narrow to the polling station. So we either call you by your phone, or when you come to check, then the old one will be taken, destroyed, and the new one is given.
Okay, so when I'm coming, I will be told to bring the old card.
But you want to check your name, you want to go with the old card.
No, assuming I don't check my name at all, I'll get a phone call.
Yes, we will contact you either a phone call or any way you can get, because we are within your police station, so you can get contact with you.
Okay, how many people have been affected by this?
I understand it's about 60,000 or so.
60,000.
Yes.
How many people did you register in total?
It's about 16.9 million.
Okay, and how many districts are these 60,000 people in?
I know it's about 100, other 100, 110.
Okay, and you are saying that this is a historical problem that the EC is used to?
Well, in 2012, I did Central Town also. All the people who were in that particular district, their dynamics were replaced. It affected Ouija, a lot of them. So what I'm saying that these are issues that normally happen. The system will detect it at the data center, and the new cards are printed and replaced.
We were told that we are going to have a new voters registration system that will correct a lot of the errors of the old. Should we now be concerned that we probably didn't get a brand new system, or we didn't get the upgrade that we were expecting?
No, everything is different. The major difference between this and the old one is the facial recognition that we talked about. The major difference is that, unlike the previous one, where you do manual verification, the system will not recognize it. At the end of the day, the system will tell you how many people were verified through the complaint, how many people were verified through the facial recognition, how many people were manually verified. So this one is computer immune system.
The director of the...
But I think my brother made a statement. I want to correct him.
Okay.
He was saying that if we do the printing and we give them to new people, then they can go and say that they have filled an inclusion form. When you fill an inclusion form, you appear before the magistrate to state your state case. And when we are coming, we will come with a short document from 1A and from 1C. Because if your name is missing, the short document is not missing. So anybody who thinks that you can come out if you just card, apply for inclusion and you have been good, it's not, it can't be the case. Because you are from 1A, which was manual phrase there, from 1C, which is the product of the printing, is also there. So there's no way you can come out with a new card and claim that your name should be included and remained there. So that's not possible.
Okay. Elvis Afriankar is the director of the NDC's election. He's been around elections for a long time. He says that his people were not satisfied with the explanations that you gave at today's meeting. Did you achieve a sort of reasonable explanation to the team, the political parties at IPAC today?
Some of these things, if I say it, it's like I'm defending my cause. If it would be better, you get those people who were there for them to speak to it. So as far as I am concerned, I believe by the time everybody was leaving, there's some form of understanding.
Okay, do you have a question for him?
Hold on, he has
a question for you. Yes, please go on.
So, first of all, did you go to IPAC today to go and seek the inputs of the political parties, or you went to IPAC with a predetermined program that you were going to do X, Y, Z, and you went to inform the participants of IPAC?
No, what the IPAC meeting, there were two issues. The first one is about issues coming out of the exhibition. So we needed to explain to them because we need to, the complaint was that we were not communicating enough. So we went there, explained what has transpired. If you have any challenge, you ask your question, then we explain the first phase. Then the second phase was to inform you about the registration that we are going to do.
So that has been the challenge. In the past, what happens is that you go to IPAC, the political parties have views, it is discussed, the EC listens, it also presents its views, it's distilled. At the end of the day, whatever comes out, you see traces of the inputs of all parties. With this particular commission, it has always been informative. They've taken a position, and that is what they will do anyway. For example, our director of IT said, today. And it's wrong for somebody to say because you were not physically present. Go in their individual
what
capacities.
What did he propose?
He proposed that there should be a joint technical team made up of all the political parties. When we're doing the first biometric register, there were two committees. I allowed you to finish. Make me finish, please? Yeah. Let me make my point. So there should be, when we're doing the previous biometric exercise, there were two committees, a legal committee, a technical committee, made up of NDC rep, MPP rep, and then the smaller parties, one rep. And then you bring civil society and the donors. So you have a situation where all the parties have an input. So the systems, the processes, the kind of software, hardware, everything, you are part of it.
Yeah.
So if there's any challenge, you all can come in and say, this is how we solve it. In this particular instance, who were not involved? They didn't involve us. We proposed it, they refused, both at the legal and technical level.
So there's today no legal and technical committee?
No. Today that there's a problem, our IT director proposed it. Ask them, what was the answer?
Please, Doc, do you want to do a technical committee with all the parties?
That's why I said it would have been better a technical person in there. Kwame Griffith, it was only Madam Akwerenko who was sitting between myself and Kwame Griffith. Kwame Griffith didn't mention any technical committee today. Maybe I didn't hear, but as far as I know,
he was not alone.
He didn't mention the technical committee.
Would you have the minutes of today's meeting to verify tomorrow when you get to the office so we can follow up?
The public affairs will have a minute.
But it's not the loan. It was a representation.
Now, as far as you remember, the NDC rep did not propose a technical committee today.
Because I am 100% sure.
It is 100%. Not true. Even when they were starting the process,
We proposed a technical legal committee. They will not listen.
But is it true that you don't have any committee at all of the political parties, whether technical, operational, technical, legal, or technical?
You see, in 2012, we have never done biometric. So the committee was formed to solicit for information and how big things are done in other counties. We have already acquired the scale of biometric. We already changing the system. The legal issue, because we need to develop a new CI that will incorporate the issue of biometric, because it was not part of our system. Now it's already part of our system. So we didn't change anything as far as the biometric was concerned, because everything was already there. So the reform and legal committee will not change anything, because it has, whatever we did was based on the previous one. Nothing changed.
Good.
Okay, so the point you are making is that because we are doing the new biometric, you needed to have them together to set the template. That now the template is set.
So
is that what it means?
So that was what they said, that they didn't need our inputs. They were already knowledgeable. They had experience, and the result is what we are seeing today, where you go to a police station and then you have one person's name and all the pictures are one person.
But it says it's a curable defect.
And then you see,
and it's not the first time it's happening.
But that is even the most frightening.
But is it curable?
Hold on. That's the most frightening. He talks about 2012, it happened, 2016, it happened, and in 2020, it's happening. Really? Really?
Is it curable?
I don't know.
Was it curable in 2012?
I don't know. No, because we do not have the scale. That's the major difference.
He said 60,000.
60, hold on. Yeah. When you asked him, he mentioned just a few districts. He mentioned Weja, he mentioned...
No, but I asked him a specific question. He said 110 districts.
110 districts.
Involving 60,000 people.
Now.
Yeah.
100. That's his... Now, in the previous ones, you should tell us how many were the people who were involved.
You are suspecting it will be lower.
Definitely lower. Okay. We've been involved in this.
But is this still curable?
That is what we don't know, because they have not told us...
But this is the biggest register that we've had anyway. 15.9 million is the biggest register.
So...
So in the scale
I'm saying that we have been involved with this thing at the minutest level.
Yeah, I know that.
And then we usually you have name changing, some challenges here in one polling station or another. But this one, they themselves admit that it's in 100 districts.
Yes, 110.
That's
he
unprecedented.
Said. It may be the unprecedented. Are you confident that it's curable?
They haven't given us the confidence.
We are listening to you now.
What should be the basis of that?
I want to establish is that if the commission has not informed the people that there has been duplicate of ID cards, we wouldn't have known.
When did the commission inform the people? It was after the video,
and we put it out in the public domain.
Yes,
before they came and said misleading video, it is not true.
Okay,
then in the
you made that
body
point.
Of the commission, then they agreed.
Let me ask you, Doc. When did the commission inform the people, and who did they inform? Exactly. By what means?
Let's take them one by one. The video that you talking that we said is misleading. If you listen to the voiceover, you will say that we are doing registration. That's what the video was saying. So the community said it's misleading. The people are not doing registration. They are only laminating. So no matter what the question you ask is, if you are doing registration, there should be video case and the rest. There's nothing like that. So the misleading was with respect to the voiceover that we are doing new registration. Nobody is denying the fact that the ID cards were being laminated, but it was not new registration. Two, I also want to establish that. But because of possible use of the ID card for other purposes, for voting, the ID numbers will not have any effect. Because if you go there, your BVI kit will be scanned, your picture will appear, you are verified biometrically, you vote. It has nothing to do with the ID card. But because people normally use the ID card for other purposes, that's why we decided to change. So it is not fatal that the ID card is wrong, so you can't vote. And I want to say again that whether you have an ID card or not, on the 7th December, once you are duly registered, you can still vote.
Okay, your point is made, but my question still stands. How did you inform people about this anomaly? By what means did you inform them, and when did you inform them?
Well, our policy as I've been doing is that we bring them, send them to the polling station, contact the people involved, and give them the card.
So when did you do that?
We're doing that exhibition.
Okay, so you didn't plan to inform the political parties about this anomaly at all?
No, because the rest are the exhibitionists will be involved. the rest were there doing the registration. Mm-hmm. So us, and we are there at the center with them. So we'll do the distribution with them.
Okay, so the political party agents who are at the exhibition center, they will find out at the time that you bring the cards that these people's cards need to be replaced.
Exactly.
But where there's such an anomaly in the process, the chronological process towards elections, there is an anomaly in the middle of the process. We have done voters registration. We are expecting to do exhibition. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, we have discovered this. Don't you think that the political parties, being your principal partners, should be told that there is an anomaly?
That's what I was saying, that it doesn't affect the right to vote or not to vote. So we get to the center, I have a problem with my card, the parties are there, my card is changed, the old one is destroyed. That is our understanding.
But today you told the political parties.
They said that they were not aware. We asked the district officers and the region directors. So they have held meetings with the region level and the district level and explained to them already.
When?
Okay, so today you told the political parties about supplementary voting. That's not material to December. You told them. Yes, you told them about supplementary voting. Is that material to December 7th? Why were you telling them?
Registration.
Supplementary registration, yes. Sorry, registration.
Yes.
Why were you telling them?
Pardon?
Why were you telling them about supplementary registration?
Because this one, new registration, people who have not registered are coming to register. The parties will be there. They have to bring the agents there. And we are doing it at the district offices. This is a new registration. So they need to know that we are going to add other people's name to the register.
Given your experience at the Electoral Commission, do you agree that the relationship between the EC and the political parties exhibited on the IPAC platform has changed? The dynamics of it has changed. Is it true?
Well, I don't, because you see, these are normal things. When the party change positions, they always come at the Electoral Commission. If you take the previous one, MPP was also doing the same thing. So nothing has changed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, political parties in opposition in Ghana are fond of giving the Electoral Commission troubles.
And that's always I ask them the question. Does it mean that when they're in power, they're able to do something with the commission? And as a result, when they're over power, they become I don't know.
So in 2016, was the MPP giving the EC troubles the same way?
But I don't know whether it led to BCRAC Cup committee and the rest. You were in Ghana, you know it. My office, I was there in Kumasi. Wouldn't me have press conference 5 times in my office in Kumasi? These are not new things.
But right now, the MPP is not complaining that much, are they?
That's what I'm saying, that when they are in power, it's a different ballgame. But I believe that our system is so credible that the inbuilt integrity is that you cannot cheat money. So at the end of the day, the decision of Ghanaians will be the decision that will be the
I think by now, Ghanaians must be used to, and I'm sure you know that, Ghanaians must be used to the fact that people cannot rig elections in this country, because we have seen ruling parties lose elections.
Exactly.
Like 2008, like 2016. So I think that on the part of Ghanaians, we are fine that the elections will not be rigged.
That is the level. That is the highest level of naivety and absurdity.
Why is it naivety? Because, we have history to back it.
Hold on. So why do we put systems in place?
Well, yeah, we do. But since 2008,
why do we put systems in place
to forestall those things?
Good. So if those systems become defective, and there are loopholes in the system, what does it mean?
But he's talking about...
No, please, answer the question.
Well, if there are loopholes, it changes. But he's talking about a problem has been around for a while.
No, this is... You see, I'm happy you allowed him to speak. He has displayed to Ghanaians the kind of IPAC we have. Belligerent, they won't listen, there is no problem, and every day the problems are compounded. We, as political parties, came together with the EC. You give ID cards to
our party people, in the presence of party representatives, to ensure openness and transparency. Subsequently, you discover that you have a problem. What do? You inform the political parties that, look, we have a challenge, and these
and
are
this
the
is how we are going to solve it.
That we're going to put in place. And then everybody is aware. You don't do that. Then we find out that this is what is going on. We raise it, you say it's normal. How can it be normal? How can it be normal? And you see...
Let me get him off the phone, then you can continue.
From 2012...
Hello, Doc, are you still there?
I'm around.
Don't you think that the last sentences that Obviously Free Ankara made is sort of something that morality seems to be whispering to me that perhaps we should do that? I mean, you should inform the political parties that we have discovered a problem, but we do have a solution. Should we wait for the NDC to write and then now we explain?
Paul,
yes.
I wish one day we can invite you to our IPAC meeting. Today's meeting, all the political parties were there. That's why that I would wish you can get not the Electoral Commission, not MPP, not NDC, but different person to talk to it. We go there and we talk about this. But as I said, that it's a issue of trust. That when the party is in opposition, Electoral Commission will rig the election. When they are in power, I believe if the CC were in power, they will be defending the Electoral Commission as we speak. Because they know within themselves that the question is that there's no way you can change it. They know.
Okay, thank you, Doc. I'm taking him off. Is that okay?
Well, but he spoke out before I came in, so he's eating into my time.
So can I take him off?
I don't care. I don't really care. It doesn't matter.
Okay, say good evening to him, then I take him off.
I've already greeted him. Let me spend my time constructively on the issues.
Okay, Doc. Thank you very much. Good night.
Now listen. Okay. It's sometimes it's an insult to our intelligence. To say, you have a watchman in your house. So nobody can steal you. There's very elementary lack of depth.
But why do you bring a watchman? You bring a watchman to forestall theft.
Yes.
Yeah, so
but you know watchmen have been in people's houses and they've been stolen, they've been robbed.
Yeah.
All right?
Yeah.
It could be due to many factors. The watchman could sleep. The watchman could have been compromised. He probably overate. He drank. You know the story of the watchman who, the master king was, so I was dreaming, and he was sacked.
Yeah.
So we put systems in place to ensure that there is integrity. So where you have defects in the system, it opens loopholes for people to manipulate the system. That is number one. Number two, haven't we had cases where elections have gone to court?
Only in 2012?
No. I'm talking about even parliamentary elections.
Yeah, parliamentary elections.
That have been decided one way or the other.
Yes, yes.
So he's saying the system is completely foolproof.
No, I'm saying that Ghanaians are used to a good election.
The empirical evidence shows that argument is bogus. It lacks intellectual depth. It's a very blasé primary school kind of thing.
What about the point he makes that opposition parties always have this belligerent attitude towards
it? The point is we must look at the evidence. Okay? You don't do those general statements. It's too simplistic. What are the facts? Okay, so one, this EC came into office, they are posturing. Boss Manasari says in public that the NDC is an existential threat to Ghana's democracy. Did I put it in his mouth? The referee. He goes further to say...
Did he not say that before he became the referee?
No, he said it was in office. And the last time I was here, you checked. So check again. And then he goes further to say the EC will not supervise the NDC's internal elections. That's the referee.
Yeah, I remember that. Because you people attacked him, isn't it?
But he spoke irresponsibly and withdrew his attention that you can't speak like that. Okay? And then we go to, this is my personal experience. We go for a meeting. There's a four-point agenda item. We discuss these items after 3.5 hours. The EC now comes out, issues a statement and says, we've all agreed that there'll be a new biometric register. It was not on the agenda. Was never discussed extensively. Somebody just asked a question and said, we are contemplating buying new equipment. How does that become all the parties agreed? So when you do that, you undermine the confidence. The same EC comes out to tell the whole public. In fact, they go to parliament and they swear under oath and tell the whole Ghana that they will use the Ghana card will not be part of the requirements for the new register. Didn't they say that? And then they said they will rely on the old card. Didn't they say that?
Yeah.
In fact, in their public presentation, slide 27, They said that they would depend on the new cadres there. And then for no reason, without any explanation, they just changed their mind. So if you have an EC that does this, lie to the eminent advisory committee, I also was welcomed by elections, the EC said nothing went on. I watched the video recently. I was shocked. Everybody
You're talking
knew
about Madame Jimenez's testimony.
Yes. It's so scandalous. So if you have an EC that behaves like this,
she said nothing went on at the polling stations.
But everything went on at the polling station.
No, in terms of the violence.
It did. We saw it. What are you talking about?
The Ayawaso Wesogon violence happened, there's the Sam George one, happened outside the polling station.
Who told you that?
I saw the video.
No, I live there. You're talking about
But it was a car were on the road. He was talking to a car. That's not a police station.
No, you don't know the place.
No, that's not a police
station. That's a cluster of police stations, please.
What does that mean? What does that mean, a cluster of police
stations? It means when you have a big school,
Yes.
have many, many polling stations, A, B, C, D.
Yeah, but
so there were polling stations dotted all
over.
So
there were police stations nearby.
There's nothing to argue
about. Go on.
So in the face of all that, he said nothing happened. Recent registration, people died, gunshots. He said it was very peaceful. So if you have an EC that behaves like this,
people died in the recent registration.
You didn't know? You haven't heard of Silas?
I know how Ash Kumsin shot.
You haven't heard of Silas? Paul, where have you been?
Who is Silas?
Silas in Banda. A young man. He was stabbed by
in the Bono Hafo region.
Ah, because he's an ordinary person, Paul. You are not that kind of person I know.
No, I know.
So how could you forget? A young man died.
Was it related to registration?
Yes. You don't know? I'm shocked.
I know somebody died, but the police report he was registered.
Of course. And the boys who did it the previous day, they had gone to cause mayhem at a registration center. They were arrested immediately. Call came, order from above. They released them. The second day, they went on rampage and stabbed that boy to death.
And you said the EC said nothing happened?
Nothing. It said it was very peaceful. So you say we should take them at their word? Now let's come back to the issues. I'm saying that these are not just normal, everyday occurrences. It shows a certain trend, okay? That and majority of the things are happening in our strongholds. I'm choosing my words carefully. Majority, okay? Because
majority of what kind of things?
So I've told you about missing names. Mm-hmm. The names have just vanished, mm-hmm. Okay? He's trying very vainly to explain the double cuts or the multiple cuts.
Yeah, he did.
Okay?
Yeah.
He hasn't succeeded, but let's even give that to
him. Well, he sounds convincing.
So what about the names that vanished?
Yeah, that he explained to me earlier, that it was a transfer issue and that it has been resolved.
It is not being resolved.
The 95%
we are getting, we get, as I speak to you now, by the time I'm done, I'll show you many more reports as I speak now. They still keep coming. Resolved where? Ashiaman, 7,000. Do you know the implications of 7,000 people waking up and going to the polling station on election day and not finding their name?
He said everyone who has a card will vote.
But that is, he said that is preposterous.
Why?
Let me come to another issue. They took money from government to buy 75,000 BVDs.
Mm-hmm.
Where are the BVDs?
Why do you ask that question?
Because what you do in 2012, we didn't deploy BVDs at the polling stations.
Mm-hmm.
Remember in 2012, we had to vote for 2 days.
Yes.
Because the BVDs subsequently were found to be defective,
mm-hmm.
battery problems. So with that experience, all the subsequent registrations, mm-hmm. BVDs are deployed.
Mm-hmm.
The essence is that it ensures the validity and veracity of the name. You go, you are verified, and it gives integrity and confidence to the system.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, it also helps you to test the BVD.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So whether they've bought them or not, we don't know.
So to do a test run?
A test run.
They are not doing that in this
exhibition. They are not doing that.
So when people show up, what do they do?
They just deployed 5,000
of the BVDs.
Mm-hmm. Now, for those 5,000 BVDs, they didn't discuss with the political parties.
In how many polling stations?
Good question. We don't know.
How did they choose which polling stations the BVDs will go
exactly
to?
Exactly the point I'm making. That is the EC that we have. So they determine, and they'll tell you, we are independent. You know, it's total rubbish. So they determine.
That's a harsh word for the electoral commission.
Okay, it's not making sense. Yeah, should I use foolishness?
No. That rubbish and foolishness are both harsh.
So give me something in between.
It's unfortunate.
No. This is brazen.
So you are suspecting them?
No, you see, suspicion is not just in a vacuum, right?
Mm-hmm.
You look at the trajectory of events. Why would adults, intelligent people, so one doctor, one something something, another one who says he's a doctor, we go for a meeting.
What do you mean? I'll ignore that.
Yes, you know.
Okay.
You go for a meeting, mm-hmm. 3.5-hour meeting. We hold extensive deliberations on issues. And you come out and inform the whole world that we have agreed on something that didn't happen. immediately you do that, you raise suspicion. Why do you want to do this? It doesn't make sense. What is the point? Because we've had a biometric register before. The previous one, there were extensive consultations. IPAC, outside IPAC, civil society, everybody was brought in. There were subcommittees. So if indeed there are problems with this kind of register, you want to deal with it, go through the same process, and everybody would feel that they are part of it. You didn't do that. Subsequent meetings, you call us for meetings, and then you say, we should go and look at the display. We say, why? We cannot be part of this. I've explained that to you. So that posturing tells us that these people, either they have an agenda, which is procurement-based, and I think Emmanuel and
but if the agenda is only procurement-based, no, we won't be on that now.
I'm saying one of the agendas, and one of the ways to manipulate an election is to have a defective system, a system that can be easily tampered with. It's one of the ways. You see, when we say these things...
In 2012, when we voted twice, was it defective? When we voted twice in 2012, was it defective?
It was defective.
The Supreme Court seemed to suggest that it was defective.
Good. It was defective.
Yeah.
And that is why we learn, we improve upon it. So subsequent ones, you build on a system.
2016 was not defective.
So when we have built on that system, mm-hmm. and you come and say, even that one is defective, and therefore you want to improve upon it, you don't go back and say, in 2012, we had those problems, 2016...
Don't we have enough time to correct these things? Because even America are experiencing difficulties with their systems for election. Mm-hmm. Given the COVID, the options and alternatives that they are proposing, mm-hmm. they are experiencing difficulties. People are doing postal voting. They are not sure whether they will get it. President Trump doesn't want post offices to participate, etc. So that's not a problem that should speak to malice and an agenda against the political party, should it?
It should.
No, shouldn't.
Because you shouldn't look
so
at
in America, should you people shouldn't, think that the system is against a political party?
I don't want to get into foreign policy debate, but we all know that America has a very peculiar problem.
Yes, I know that, but I'm saying
embodied
that
in something.
So we have time to fix our problem.
How much time do you have? 73 days?
No, he said
election.
Within 3 days they will fix all that missing.
And they had how many months to create the mess?
No, he said within 3 days they will fix all that. And do you believe that or not?
No, I don't.
You doubt it?
I don't doubt it. I don't believe it because mm-hmm. I cannot take the word of the EC at face value. I cannot. They have proven it to us consistently. When they wrote their own Bible, because that document is like their Bible, mm-hmm. said, this is what we're going to do. We'll use the card, we'll not use Ghana card, said it to the whole world, civil society, international community, eminent persons, defended it. I was at a meeting with the flag bearer, Bosman Asari, I'll mention him. He swore. He said, never, it will not happen. And then a few months down the line, they go and do completely opposite. Don't give any cogent reasons. And that same EC, the flaws, the things that we warn them about, that if you do this, these are the potential pitfalls. And I keep saying that it is not for nothing that the ECOWAS protocols, international best practice, all depict and common sense. That you don't introduce new systems into an electoral system, especially new technology. You don't do a new electoral roll 6 months before an election. Because these are, even if it is human error, okay, here we are. Now, ask me, all these things that have happened, do you think that the people of Ashiaman who woke up and on the first day of the exhibition, 21,000 of their names were not found?
21 or 7?
21,000.
But I think they've been found now.
No, so they found 14,000.
Yes.
And you see, again, let me show you the duplicity of the EC. Mm-hmm. So we as a political party, you know they're supposed to give us the register before exhibition.
Well, is it not after exhibition?
No, before.
Okay.
And then they're also supposed to publish it on their website. I should have asked him.
They haven't done both.
They haven't done that. They gave us, they asked us to bring a flash drive on the 7th of September, which we did. They gave us the flash drive on the 16th of September. Then the following day, they called us, 17th, that the flash drive was problematic. There were mistakes on it.
So one day I've handed over to you.
Yes.
So you should bring it back.
Yes.
So you took it back.
Yeah, we took it back. Of course, we took a copy and took it back. Mm-hmm. So the first day of the registration, we did not have copies of the register. That alone is an anomaly.
Why did you take the copy, the information on the flash drive before sending it back to the EC? What
because
was it about?
It's ours.
Okay.
It's ours.
Did you tell them that you have the information anyway?
We have the information anyway.
Did you tell them?
That one I won't answer. The IT people can answer. They took it, sent it back. They gave us another one. Mm. Okay? Now, on that first flash drive, there were mistakes. And apparently, they have sent it all across the country. Because subsequently, we saw communication between the EC head office and all their district officers telling them that they should not release that information to the public and that they should get back to the EC offices to collect the new data. So that was the data that the member of parliament Thursday went and did not see his name on the register. Then he realized that many people around him could not find their names. Immediately he did an audit and realized that 21,000 names were missing from the register. And I already told you that we have the end of day report. So we have our register in a way. So he wrote to the EC, complained. The EC now changed the data, okay, all across the country, including ours. Then they now extracted the page that had the picture of the MP, because this one now had the picture, the details of the MP. And in their response, they said that the MP lied and that these are his details in the register. I mean, how do you do this? And you say, I should have confidence in these people? They lie and lie and lie without any conscience and compulsion.
What projections then are you making?
What projections
are you making between now and December? President Mahama made an important statement that NDC will not accept the results of a flawed election.
Oh, of course.
Even if the NDC were to win it. Does it include even if you win it?
The processes must be clear.
So that when President Mahama says they will not accept the results of a flawed election, does it include an election that makes him victorious?
No, but the processes must be fair and clear. If you have 7,000 names in Ashanti,
you're not answering my question. When President Mahama says he will not accept the results of a flawed election,
I understand your question very well.
Yes, but you're not answering it.
Yes, I am answering it in the proper context because he said it within the context.
Yes.
Okay. The context of my answer is that with these kinds of problems, where you have 7,000 people with their names not in the Ashanti list, that is unacceptable.
But when that 7,000, used to be 21,000 and it's now 7, that's definitely an improvement.
No, but it is, you see, again, that is the
24
problem.
24 hours ago, it was 21,000. Now it's 7,000. That's an improvement.
The attempt to downplay and make it
no,
look
not to
like
downplay, but nothing, to look at it, look at it in a positive light.
No, you cannot look at it in a positive light.
But
you
it is certainly positive. 21 to 7, you know, it's positive.
7,000 names out of a register is unprecedented in the history of Ghana.
Well,
So but you cannot look
21,000 names is worse than 7,000.
Say you have cancer, but this is good cancer. There's nothing like bad good cancer.
It is a progress. It's a progression.
This cannot be a progression.
But it's a progression.
An anomaly which is unacceptable and ab initio.
But it's curable.
How can they cure? They should show us.
Because they have cured 21 to 7. 14,000 redeemed.
Good.
So that's curable.
The only way we would have had assurance, one, is if they had a track record of people who tell the truth. Two, if they tell us...
I can't speak to that. I don't think that's fair.
No, but I've given you
that the EC officials are people who don't speak the truth.
But I've given you copious evidence. I'm not speaking out of malice. I've given you copious evidence. They are documents. I showed it to you here the last time. It was their Bible and their Quran.
Yes. The presentation where they said that they will use the...
Yes must be yes and your no must be no. So if at the end of the day, for no reason, and that issue has a very germane impact on the entire electoral system. You think it's nothing?
It means a lot. On the figures, it looks like they are remedying it.
So back to the figure. First of all, if they're able to be open and transparent with us, that's why we said, let's do a technical audit. Let's have our team, let's all look at it. Because after all, he himself admitted that in the previous times, we were all part of the people who designed
the system. He explained that because we're starting something new.
Okay, so now you say you are improving and you are getting worse figures.
Back to President Mahama's statement.
Yes.
He will not accept the results of a flawed election.
Yes.
Does it include an election that makes him victorious?
No, but if the election makes him victorious, it means that the system has been fixed.
If the election makes him vanquished, it means the system has not been fixed.
But if in the face of all these evidence, you see, you can't take things out of context. You must look at the context.
Okay, so if on December 6th, we find or you make projections that the system has not been fixed, and President Mahama contests the election and he wins, what happens?
If we find that the system
has not been fixed,
that's hypothetical. We don't know. That's why for now the discussion should be focusing on ensuring that they do the right thing.
You don't like the EC's posture? You don't?
No, I don't.
If the posture doesn't change, what happens?
If the posture doesn't even change, but the systems are in place, we'll take it like that. Because I'm not responsible
I'm sure the systems will change.
That's what where our focus
that's what he assured us. I'm sure the systems will change.
As for the people, they've grown old. They probably will not change.
Okay, but I'm sure the systems will change.
So that's what we are looking at.
Given our country's
That is what we are looking
given
at.
Given our country's appetite for peace, and a great election,
yes.
I'm sure that all hands will be on deck and the systems will
work. No, but you see, if the posturing of the EC is that we, and you ask very intelligent and insightful questions, so why, at what point did you inform the political parties? Why did you not inform the political parties? And he was fumbling, dancing around, and we took it to the districts. It's only because we did the expose. That is when they came out after that expose and said, oh, we've been doing this, and therefore you send your political agents to go and do
that. On your part, in the context of trust, why is it that when you found something that looked like an anomaly, you did not inform the EC, but you published it?
No, I didn't say we published it.
When the video came out,
yes.
You wrote a press statement upon the video.
Mm-hmm.
Why didn't you consult the EC and say that, can you explain this? We've seen this. Instead of writing a public letter to them.
You are not coming to tell us how we should do it.
No, I'm asking you. Because we are talking about
it within
the context
of public domain.
We're talking about the context of trust.
Hold on. It's a matter within the public domain. The video had gone viral.
Mm-hmm.
We were getting reports from all over. In fact, the first person to have alerted us about this was Honorable Eriko Poku.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? He said, we are hearing that the EC officers are publishing.
When you got this, the first person to inform would have been the EC.
Hold on. We are too experienced for this kind of thing. Listen, one thing about election cycles is that you have to be careful of information. You hear all manner of things.
Mm-hmm.
All manner of things, good, bad, ugly. So when you hear one thing, you pause. And then you do further checks. Okay? So we're checking. We're getting more and more information. We're hearing this, we're hearing that. You want to put, that's why I don't do a lot of media, if you observe.
Mm-hmm.
Before I come out and say something, I have checked and checked and quadruple checked. So that's why I can say anything.
So when you finish checking,
so
why didn't you inform the EC?
At the time we're checking, that this went viral.
Okay.
And so once it went viral and everybody was talking about it, we owe the responsibility to our political party to let Ghanaians know that, hey, these and other things are things that we have seen. There's nothing wrong with that. That matter is in the public domain.
Well, it indicates that you don't trust the EC.
We are not a cult.
No, it's not a cult. You don't trust the EC because you could have gone to them and then come to the public and said, the EC has explained, but we are not satisfied with their explanation.
Pause. This didn't work. Listen, I can count, if I knew, I would have brought about 5 letters that I had personally written. Signed to the EC, they never respond.
You as director of elections?
Yes.
They don't respond to your letters?
They don't respond. Even general secretary, they don't respond.
Oh, your general secretary writes, they don't respond?
They don't respond.
They receive it and they don't respond?
I'm telling you. And the gentleman I sent, he's here somewhere. Make sure it is registered. Go to the chairperson's office, one to the registry, received, signed. They don't respond. Copious. Tomorrow, if you will be fair to me, tomorrow I'll send you copies and put it out there.
Okay, send.
So people will see
letters you have written to the EC that they haven't responded.
Yes, on a diverse range of
issues. I'll first send it back to them.
Yes.
That this is a complaint.
Diverse range of issues.
From the director of NDC.
So we put it out there.
Okay, so the concern, the history is that you knew that the EC might not respond because your relationship with them is not that good.
First of all, might not respond is historical.
Mm-hmm.
We have every right. When there's an issue in the public domain that has generated so much public interest, wild all over the place, which has a bearing on the sanctity of the electoral process, the confidence of our people in the EC and in us, for us to speak to it, to let our people know that we are alive to our responsibilities. And indeed, the EC communicates to the public, even to us.
But because
public.
You didn't have an explanation for it, how did you explain it to the general public?
Pause. When the recent all the activities that they have engaged in, how many of them did they inform the political parties or the NDC?
No, I don't know, but I'm saying that when you saw the video, you didn't have an explanation for it. You saw cards were being made. You didn't have an explanation for it.
Of course, we did our checks.
And what was the explanation?
I've already told you that Honorable Eriko Poku was the one who hinted us the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And we said, this is very irregular. Why hasn't the EC formally informed us? But anyway, let's wait. Let's check. So we're checking. We have a system where within hours, we can check what is going on in almost the entire country.
Mm-hmm.
So we started checking. And some places there were confirmations. Some were coming like rumor, we've heard this, and some names. So we had to put all those things together. And mind you, it wasn't only one issue, as I told you. So we realized that there were so many, many, many issues. So whilst getting our letter written, and then informing our flag bearer that, hey, this thing, you are there campaigning. Perhaps half of the people who are you are campaigning to don't have their names on the voters' roll. And therefore, it's important that we all look at this thing critically. We haven't done anything wrong. We did the right thing by being proactive. Otherwise, today we wouldn't have known.
Your projections are that the system might work.
Oh, if it is fixed, why not? We want it to work.
Okay.
That's why we're raising the issues.
Okay.
You know, but it should be more open and transparent. If you have not been...
You're asking for more transparency from the
issue.
What are the other processes left after exhibition was left? They have to hand you over the full register.
Certified register.
No,
but therein lies the danger. That is why when people are trying to downplay this issue, oh, it's just a few, you know, it happened in 2012. You know the implications?
Mm-hmm.
You know we are in the process of preparing to file nominations.
Mm-hmm.
You know how nominations are filed?
You have to get people representing
across
from
the country.
Registered voters.
Registered voters. So they fill the forms. Now, those forms are then taken to the EC and they are vetted.
Mm-hmm.
If one of the names are found to be defective, what happens?
If one is found to have double registered or that his name is not in the voters' register.
Good.
Yeah, so that's why they will give you the register. Good. So select people whose names are in the register they've given
you. But as it is now, the register they've given us, while the processes we are going through is full of defects.
But they will give you another register.
Yes, but...
So rely on that one.
No, but we are saying that based on what is going on now, we have cause to be alarmed.
Absolutely.
Because what happens if any of these people who are now signing the forms for us, they are part of the Ashaman 7000?
They are now signing?
Yes.
Okay, so if the Electoral Commission gives you a register that Paul Adomochi is in, and you let me endorse a form for President Mahama, and you take it to the EC, under no circumstance should they be able to say that this name is not qualified. Because they have given you a document with the name in there.
Yeah, but here is a situation where they said, so I've given you examples of situations where in one polling station, all the people have one ID card number.
Yes, that doesn't make a difference.
It is
their problem.
Yes.
It's the EC's problem.
So they cannot tell you that. You don't understand the electoral system.
If the EC gives you a document with names in it, all of those names are qualified to endorse President Mahama.
So why are they changing it then? If there's no
why
problem,
are they, changing
they should leave it.
Because I asked him the question but he made that point. He said on voting day.
So there's no
problem. If you have a card, you will be allowed to vote.
So Paul, then there's no problem.
There is no problem, but there's an anomaly.
What's the difference?
The difference is that anomaly is something that can be cured.
Uh-huh. And problem is?
So they are curing it.
So problem is?
Problem is a fait accompli.
You know, please. You see, these are just words.
No, but I don't understand why your concern is about those who endorse President Mahama. If the Electoral Commission has given you a register that those people's names are in it, they are qualified.
No, please. I think you're being oversimplistic.
Maybe I am because I don't understand the process.
Absolutely oversimplistic.
Mm.
There is a document called the Certified Register.
And names are in it.
Good. That Certified Register, you know why we do exhibition?
No.
And deduplication, okay? You go through all these processes. Political parties will do their checks and everything before you have a Certified Register.
Yes, but the Certified is after the exhibition.
Yes, after the exhibition.
Yeah.
And we're saying that if you look at the plethora of issues that we have so far, we have not been told whether the EC have properly identified the causes of the problem. We have not been told what mechanisms
or
measures
they have put in place. So you're anticipating that the certified one that you will get will be defective. That's your anticipation.
No, but based on what we have now, any reasonable, normal person, when an EC has been given 1 billion CDs to do a register.
That's if you think that what we have is not curable.
But the problem is with us now.
Yes, but
the doctor has not been able to diagnose properly. In fact, the doctor is lying.
I don't know about that.
The doctor is lying. He's not telling you the truth.
So if you think the problem we have is not curable,
no,
then your anticipation will be that...
Paul.
So what's the point you're making? I want you to make the point that the certified register that will come to you is not good.
No, will not be good. No. The point I'm making is that for the first time in the history of our country, we have a register where there are unprecedented, huge, gargantuan number of errors. It's never seen before.
Are these errors curable?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
They are telling us it is.
But we cannot take them at their word.
Okay.
Because
you don't believe
them? No. Because at the start of this process, they told us that the previous register was horrible and that they were going to give us a supersonic register.
Yes.
Now this register has started and we are seeing problems that we never saw, even with the bad one.
Correct.
So any reasonable thinking person, will you not be concerned? Number two, they are not being honest and truthful about the causes of the problem. If we knew, for example, where we asked that all the political parties should come together, form a technical team, and go into the system and check, and let's even have an audit of all the mechanisms. Because, see, when you're dealing with IT, when systems can be manipulated or are manipulated that way, it has huge consequences. Don't forget that the EC...
But what's the point? It's an IT problem. Why can't they solve it? Why do they need a political party to solve it? If you identify it as a technical problem, it's technical people to solve it. They can get those.
But we also have technical
people. But they can get them from.
But for purposes of transparency, didn't they have technical people before in 2012? We all came together and put the systems in place.
He said they were doing a new one.
And so now you've done the new one. So 2012, 2016, 2020 must have seen an improvement. Now we are seeing worse.
Okay, so I think that the divergence is you think it's not curable.
No.
You think it's curable?
No.
Neither?
No.
Okay.
Because.
So wrap up.
We are saying that. First of all, the EC is not being honest. They're not being candid. They've not been able to tell us the causes of the problem. Two, they've not been able to tell us the kind of mechanisms that they've
Isn't the causes of the problem that you need assurances about? Mm-hmm. Or is the solution to the problem? I'm getting worried.
Now, if
the problem has occurred, you are a stakeholder, political party, you want to know the causes. But people are telling you that we have a solution, this is the solution. But you don't want the solution, you want to know the causes.
But if you don't know the cause of the problem, and the person who is supposed to solve it, in trying to solve it, is stuttering. What assurance then would you have that he'll be able to deal with it effectively?
Yeah, but you have to give them the end of the process to make a determination that they haven't solved the problem.
No,
and that, I don't mean December 7th. I mean the next 3 days.
But that is precisely the point.
Why don't you wait for the next 3 days?
You cannot wait.
For 3 days.
You must speak.
Yeah, you can.
You
yes,
must
speak.
Draw the
it's
attention.
A democracy. Yes, you have.
Yes, to, yes. And but, that's what we're
but
doing.
But they are telling you that by the time we finish it,
and
we are
saying that we cannot take them at their word.
So what
we
would you do?
We want to see the action.
So
at
what,
the end
what,
of the day,
what would you
let's
do?
See what you've put in
but
place.
But you have seen
if
them
at the
who,
end of the day.
Yeah.
You bring it and you solve it. There will be no problem.
But
based on your track record.
But you have seen them move Ashama's defect from 21,000 to now 7,000 in 24 hours.
And I'm saying that 21,000 to 7,000. To even 500. 21,000 ab initio is even a disaster that should get us putting our hands on our word and wailing in Zion.
Nevertheless, it's curable.
We don't know.
But that is what they've showed you.
No.
There's a progression
no.
towards
so if
the zero.
No.
There's a progression
so
towards
zero.
There's a progression
hold
towards
on,
zero.
Hold on. Biologic. If they could, why didn't they cure it all at the same time?
It doesn't matter.
It does.
Well, when a matter is curable, whether you cure it instantaneously
or
whether
you
cure
know,
it within
you know,
whether you
do,
cure it
you,
within the stipulated
you,
time,
do, okay,
you have still
okay,
cured it.
Okay, let me ask you. So do you know what mechanisms they put in place to first of all detect that and what they put in place to cure the 14,000?
As a voter, it's immaterial to me.
Good.
They must cure
voter.
It.
You are talking to the director of elections of a major political party.
Why is it important
who,
to you
on,
whether
on,
they cure it
on,
or not?
Who has been involved in elections and who has seen that this gargantuan incompetence is unprecedented?
Is it curable?
I don't know.
Okay, so let's wait.
No, we
let's
can't wait.
3 days, you
no,
can't wait.
No, no, you see.
Okay,
Paul,
let's tell us your last
Paul,
word and
Paul.
Then we leave it.
So,
I think viewers are clear on what you mean.
But the point we're making is that in every registration exhibition, there are issues, challenges, change of name here, this year. What is happening now is unprecedented. It is frightening, it is gargantuan. And therefore, any attempt by anybody to downplay it and trivialize it and make it look like nothing, that person is a threat and a danger to our democracy or institution. Number two, the EC are not being candid with us. What caused these unprecedented problems? We don't know. What mechanisms are they putting in place to ensure that by the end of this process, all these issues will be solved? We don't know. Then to make it worse, in the midst of all this, they say they are now going to do further registration. So they are going to put more wahala on top of this. What is the guarantee that the further registration that they will do will not even generate worse problems?
So you think they shouldn't do it?
I've not said that. These are legitimate questions.
No, further registration is grounded on people's rights.
Good.
So you think they shouldn't do it?
No, I haven't said that, Paul. Don't be mischievous.
Yeah, but you said they are going to do further registration to compound the problem.
Yes, because you already have a problem.
So what's
your
prescription?
Your problem is generating. That is why we say, let's go into the system.
So what's your prescription? Go into the system.
Of course.
They should open up the system to you.
Of course.
Okay.
That's the prescription.
That's the solution to the problem.
IT, that's one of the solutions.
Well, you have a superior IT capacity than they
Nobody
have.
Nobody has said that, Paul.
Okay, but you said they should open it up to you.
Paul. I'm saying that when it comes to IT, nobody is a repository of all the knowledge.
Yes.
The reason why in 2012 we're able to navigate all these...
2012 is not a good example because the Supreme Court held otherwise.
Hold on. But that was the beginning.
Yeah.
Was that all the parties were involved in the process.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So... when the issues arose, the first day, when we couldn't vote, You recall that all the parties then came together and we all agreed that we should have a second voting. Because we all understood the process.
2012 election was set by the Supreme Court to be fundamentally flawed in many areas. So it's not a good example.
Yeah, but I'm telling you the process.
Do you want to use 2016?
Fine, but I'm starting from 2012 because that was when we were all involved in the process. Mm-hmm. And based on that, subsequently, all the recommendations that came out from civil society and the political parties led to an improvement in 2016. Mm-hmm. Okay? Then we had 2016. Then you said that
2016, were we all involved in the process?
Of course, we're all involved.
Okay.
Okay. Then 2020, you now said that all those systems, you are now experts, you know it all, you're going to do it all on your own. And then you go and do it, and you've brought out problems that we have never seen or experienced or witnessed before. Okay. And then you look at the context, okay? We're looking at our sub-regional. You see, I didn't want to go there.
You're taking it too far.
We have to.
You're talking about Liberian civil war.
What happened in Mali? What happened in Mali?
No, our experience of 2008.
You see?
Our experience of 2008. Sustaining an election that is bringing up 25,000 difference between two candidates puts us ahead of what's happening in Mali.
No, but you see, it is clearly simplistic thinking.
I don't think it's simplistic.
It's very simplistic. Mm. Because in Mali, what happened? Flawed register, flawed elections, incumbents, and then before, God forbid, I'm not saying that should happen.
2008 had 285,000 spoiled ballots.
That's why, spoiled ballots of 2008.
So, 208, yeah. So, nonetheless, the election was sustained.
So 25,000. 2008, did you have 21,000 names missing from Ashanti?
I don't know. He said that. You would know historically.
That's what I've been telling you. You don't know. Yeah. And who knows? I'm telling you that this is unprecedented. You don't want to listen.
Okay.
You understand me?
Why is Raymond calling
What is happening now is unprecedented.
Okay, I get it. I think you have to wrap up now.
And I'm saying that within the sub-region, every country where we have had problems after election starts with a register. Mm-hmm. When the register is not credible, when people do not have confidence in the register, when the register seems to be to have been manipulated, then it creates the atmosphere that indeed the actual election can be manipulated. Mm-hmm. And that is why we want to be sure that all the systems, processes, mechanisms, and procedures that will be put in place will ensure that we have a clean, credible register that will engender confidence in everybody. We'll go and vote. Whoever wins, will win. And we are confident that President Mahama will win this election one touch. Well, it's clear.
So this election will not be flawed then? The election will not be flawed.
No, if all the systems are put in place, there's no way President Mahama cannot win.
If the systems are not put in place, President Mahama might not win, right?
Oh, the election can be manipulated.
Okay.
It's looking...
You are saying that if it's a free, fair, transparent, and independent election, President Mahama will win.
Win one touch. Okay. In fact, the MPP will struggle to get 45%.
Okay. That would be a huge setback from 53% to less than 45%. Yes, yes. Okay.
We're on the ground. We know what is going on.
Okay.
You know, and so
okay, I think you're done. Are you?
Yes, but Paul, you see, let's not, you know, belittle.
I think you made that point. You said we shouldn't trivialize it. There are major issues.
It's a very, very major issue because imagine on the day of election that 1,000 people, 7,000.
Everyone, actually, let me read this text. It says, Paul, if 7,000 was curable, why didn't they cure it once and for all? You have a problem of 21,000 that referring to Electoral Commission, and you are only able to solve 14,000. It means you cannot solve the problem, or you would have been able to solve the 7,000 as well. One vote can make it a someone precedent. Okay, I think the point is well made. Anyway, all right. Okay. Thanks. That's by the discretion. That's all.
So we're
happy. Are you going to say a prayer for the country?
No, I don't pray in public.
Oh, you don't pray in public.
Yeah, prayer is not show. I'm an intercessor. Intercessor, we don't pray. We don't do show prayers.
So what was the latest that you're intercessing on these days?
It's none of your business. Intercession is between me and God and my team. I mean, what is all this?
Okay, viewers, that's our great senior, obviously, free anchor, director of NDC's elections in the studio. Thank you very much for watching. This good evening, Ghana. Good night.